In this video, I'm going to share how I used free CAD software, 3D printing, additional hardware, and laser cutting to improve the ergonomics and usability of my iPhone 14 Pro Max. And while this might seem like a silly, simple project, stick around because as we go along, I'm going to give you valuable insights into how I go about doing a project like this as a self-taught, non-engineer maker. Let's dive in. First, just a little bit of background. An overview of the project specifications, if you will. Have you ever noticed that your smartphone, whether an Android, iPhone, or Windows phone, has a glaring ergonomics issue? If you don't know what I'm talking about, just go ahead and pick it up right now with one hand. Do you notice what you're doing there to keep it from falling down? If you're like me, you're using your pinky finger or your other hand to keep the device from sliding out of your hand. Now, this can get tiring, causing strain on your pinky, and it's just downright annoying. Fortunately, a few years ago, I discovered the pop socket, a little piece of plastic and flexible material that sticks onto the back of your phone and then pops out to basically put a collapsible handle on it. As wireless charging became more prevalent, pop sockets have advanced to include detachable sockets, and you may remember from my 50 plus things you didn't know you could print video that I printed phone cases for my wife and I with little cutouts to minimize the distance between the phone and the charger. But then when MagSafe came out on the iPhone, they actually came out with a new version to take advantage of the snap-on functionality of MagSafe. It costs a whopping $30, but it works quite well, I'll admit. This, however, meant that you were restricted to wherever they wanted the actual handle to be centered, which in this case was in the middle of the magnetic ring. That was manageable, albeit a little bit too high when I had the normal sized iPhone. But recently I decided to splurge and upgrade to an iPhone 14 Pro Max. Gotta make sure that those YouTube shorts are top quality, after all. And I was faced with a little issue. The pop socket was in the wrong place, and suddenly I found myself resorting back to the little pinky trick all over again. Fortunately, I have a 3D printer, or like 10 of them. And thanks to Michael Laws over at Teaching Tech, I also know how to use Onshape, a parametric design software. So that's a bit of background, and we're going to get into the actual design process in just a second, but first I have to take a moment to thank this video's sponsor, which actually is Onshape. Like I mentioned, I recently converted to Onshape from Blender for like 95% of my CAD needs, and since I have, my life has literally changed for the better. And for those of you who know how powerful and easy parametric modeling is compared to mesh mixing every single point by point in Blender, you know that that's not an exaggeration. Now, I love Onshape because unlike other CAD companies, they guarantee that they're never going to turn around and charge hobbyists like me. And if you're just using it for personal use, it's guaranteed to be free forever. At the same time, if you are looking to use it at the higher levels, it has a whole suite of features for businesses, like the ability to work on a document together in real time with your colleagues, just like a Google Doc. I highly recommend Onshape because as you'll see in this video, it just makes it easy for me to turn my ideas into life. So to sign up for free, visit the link in the description below. Doing so really helps support this channel, so thank you. And thanks to Onshape for helping support my work. All right, let's get back into the project. First things first, I jumped into Onshape and sketched out my vision. Basically, I wanted to recreate the exact design of the official pop socket, but instead of centering the rubber handle piece in the middle of the magnetic ring, I would put it down as low as I possibly could. Using Onshape, this was really easy. I just needed to sketch out the design, extrude things where I wanted them, and chamfer some of the edges. Up next, it was time to add in the magnets. I created an offset plane, which basically means another sketch plane which is offset from one of the planes you already have. And drew in a ring for the magnets as well as the alignment magnets in the bottom and extruded them as a remove. Now, let's talk about the height of the magnets. Despite the fact that the original pop socket seems to have a simple rubber sticker over the back, my plan was to create the design in such a way that I could pause printing, insert the magnets mid-print, and continue, so that the magnets would be seamlessly integrated in the strongest way possible into the plastic. This clearly isn't possible when mass producing this product via injection molding, but it's one of the many benefits of 3D printing, so why not take advantage of it? Originally, I ordered a bunch of cheapy magnet stickers from AliExpress, which were clearly intended for much less demanding applications, such as adding magnetic alignment to your existing wireless charger. Because when I tried to use those, the magnetism was not nearly strong enough to hold the phone, much less deal with the strains of pulling the phone out of my pocket at different angles. I tried stacking 3 or 4 sets of these to increase the magnetism, but to no avail. I even tried a version of cylindrical magnets that I had on hand, but the polarities weren't right and the phone still wasn't completely supported. It was back to the drawing board. It took me a while to find a product that would work properly, especially because I could tell that the polarities had to be just right. Fortunately, I was able to find this product on AliExpress, which is actually designed for mounting your phone different places using MagSafe. Now we're getting somewhere. This product wasn't cheap considering it was just a handful of neodymium magnets, but I decided to order a few sets to play around with. Now, while we wait for those to arrive in the mail, let's take a moment to also talk about magnetism as a whole and how it works. We all know that magnets have a polarity, a side that attracts and a side that repels. But did you know that a magnet's strength decreases exponentially as it gets further away from another magnet? I sure didn't. This means that the difference between laying down a single 0.15 millimeter layer before inserting the magnets versus 2 layers at 0.3 millimeters in total height is not half as strong. It's actually a quarter as strong, which probably explains why the folks who make the original pop socket opted for such a thin piece of rubber to hold their magnets in. With my base design ready and the new magnets finally here, it was time to start prototyping. Now, I'm not going to bore you with the story of how I printed out about 20 of these before I figured out a bunch of various different things. One, because I didn't film any of it. I mean, I'm not Stefan at CNC Kitchen. But also, I think it's enough to just say that prototyping, or in other words, printing a bunch of parts that don't work for one reason or another, is a crucial part of this process, and it's why having a fast printer makes such a difference in being able to move your project forward faster. Because I modeled this out in a parametric design software like Onshape versus something like Blender, it was really easy to experiment with a few versions of my design and test to see if I really needed to get as close as 0.15 or 0.20 millimeters versus having the extra strength of 0.3 millimeters. And I figured out pretty quickly that more magnetism is better. And every micron did indeed count. This also meant that there was a difference in magnetic force whether I used a textured PEI sheet like the one I reviewed in my Bamboo Lab knockoffs versus the smooth Wham-Bam sheet, and I opted to print all further prototypes with the Wham-Bam sheet exclusively. With the new, stronger magnets, I now had a very solid design for the base plate that stuck to the phone beautifully. Now, it was time to convert it to a finished product. For my build, I was actually fortunate enough to have a few extra real pop sockets lying around, and so I chose to use them because they are smoother and more polished. But you could also pick up some fake ones on AliExpress for just a few bucks. But just for fun and to demonstrate how this project could be done with all 3D printed plastic parts, I also tried printing a free and open source design by Ebro002 on Thingiverse. It did require some assembly and gluing, and the final result is admittedly not nearly as thin as a real pop socket, but it works great. If I were trying to redo this without buying a real pop socket though, the first thing I'd do would be dry my TPU a bit better. And I might redesign it so that there are 2 collapsing points instead of just 1, which would make it sit flat. I would also probably make the walls just a bit thinner because at least with the 95A and 98A TPUs that I printed with, the popping action is a lot firmer and more difficult than I find comfortable. Still, it's worth noting that you definitely could do this project without buying any ready-made parts, except of course, the stronger magnets. As for printing the final product, I opted for ABS. There are a number of reasons for this, but the main one was that I might choose to vapor smooth the product a little bit later to get rid of the texture on top. I considered printing it upside down with a smooth PEX plate, but the chamfered edges would never print properly, and I didn't like the feel of the prototypes I did with filleted edges. Another reason for ABS, though, was that I sometimes find my phone in hot situations. For example, if I leave it in the sun for a few minutes while at the park, or I might leave it in the car. PLA really doesn't do well with heat, so either ABS or nylon seemed like the natural choice. All right, time to print. When I glued my pop socket onto my custom-made base, a few things stood out at me. First of all, the fit was really a bit too tight. A reminder to leave tolerances on any XY holes, or just enable the XY hole compensation in your slicer, because a 3D printer will inherently make holes smaller when it simplifies their geometry of the circles. Additionally, when testing out the product for a week or so, I realized that although the magnetic pull between the phone and the base was indeed very strong, the base would constantly lose alignment due to the fact that there was no friction between the base and the phone. I considered printing the first few layers in TPU, which has phenomenal layer adhesion and strength, but in my testing, TPU was even more slippery than ABS. Now, I didn't have access to any of the rubber filament that Zach Friedman recently tested out, and plus, it looks like it would be a real nightmare to work with, so instead, I got creative. I took a very thin piece of rubber, which was given to me years ago by a physical therapist, and I then used Onshape's built-in drawing feature and created a drawing of my model from the bottom up. This gave me the exact shape I needed. I then took that image and pulled it into the FluxBeam Studio software, scaling it up to 99% of the appropriate size. This allowed me to precisely cut a piece of rubber which wouldn't be visible when installed. Yes, I probably could have done this with an X-Acto knife, but what's the fun in that? I epoxied the rubber to my 3D printed part and voila, I now have a custom-made magnetically attaching pop socket, perfectly suited for the iPhone Pro Max size phones. Overall, I'm really happy with how this project turned out. To be fair, I still need to do that vapor smoothing to get rid of this really nasty texture because the ironing feature of my 3D printer definitely didn't turn out perfect. And if I'm honest, this pop socket is still a little bit higher than I'd like it to be. So I'm actually toying with the idea of making a thicker prototype that seats the pop socket over the magnets themselves. But all in all, this project was a lot of fun. It gave me the opportunity to sharpen my CAD skills, integrate additional parts into my build, prototype different materials on my 3D printer, and even find a cool use for my laser cutter. Oh, and since making this, a bunch of my friends have actually asked me to make one for them as well, because $30 plus shipping for a piece of plastic is honestly pretty ridiculous. Of course, I will be uploading my STLs and G-code to Printables, where you can download them for free using the link in the description, and I would appreciate if you just could give me a like and upload a make if you decide to do this project yourself. Let me know in the comments below what you thought of this video. I'd love to hear if you learned something, and as always, I'm open to suggestions for future videos. Thank you once again to Onshape for sponsoring this video, and thanks to my wonderful Patreon supporters for helping me turn this into a full-time job. Oh, and thanks to all of you once again for watching, liking, subscribing, and all that jazz, because it really does make a difference. That's all for now, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.